points in the action agenda is identifying those who face human development deficits and mapping where they are. I was wondering if you have a plan for that and how you're going to go about that, especially in some of the most poor and closed countries in the world. Mm-hmm.
Before that, let me also recognize my colleague, Tani Mukhopadhyay, who is part of the research and report team. I have been asked that, or I've been told that there are lots of work and with lots of people, and I said the first part of the statement is correct. The second part is not. There are lots of work, but there are not lots of people. Tani and I belong to that research and writing team, which is basically 8 people. So it's quite a small team. On the issue of mapping and to find the human development deficits, I think that there need to be a three-pronged approach. First, we are having discussions at the national level with not only the statistical offices, but we also have national offices in 168 countries. The UNDP has country offices. So to start a discussion on developing a kind of a methodology as how to do it. I mean, we know anecdotes. We know some things from some parts of the country, but we do not know everything. So therefore, this would be a process of mapping those who are really deprived. So that process have already started there. The second thing is one of the ways we can basically start this particular process, because we also have national human development reports. So far we have produced more than 800 reports in various countries. So that national human development process is also a kind of an instrument through which you can have more disaggregated data, disaggregated in terms of regions in a large country like Nigeria, in terms of ethnicity in a country where there is a multi-ethnic groups, and then in terms of gender, in terms of environmental challenges and that kind of thing. So that's the second one. And the third one, we believe that this kind of mapping would also be very useful when you go for the SDG monitoring. Because one of the things, if you look at the indicators, they're not only looking at the averages, but they are also looking at where the pockets of deprivations are. So I thought that this particular approach would actually not only help the policymakers at the country level to formulate policies, but also would help the global community through the national governments to have a better sense of where the deprivations are, how the inequalities are. So to short answer to your question is that, yes, we have started the process, but we are also partnering with different other entities to push forward that particular process. If I may use this 30 seconds just for a sale pitch, is that we also have introduced this year a human development app. You can download that app free. You have to go to the Apple Store and you have to say that human development app, and it's free. You can download it. It's a gold mine in a sense. First of all, it has the 25 reports over the last 26 years in all the UN languages, first. Second, it has all the data, starting with the Human Development Index for every country plotted between 1990 and 2015. And then third, it also has the 800 national and regional and sub-regional reports which you can download, which you can put in your e-book or Kindle, which you can use in terms of writing a particular paper, or you can cut and paste some of the figures that you can do. It is not interactive as yet, but I think within the next 3 months we'll make it interactive so that if you want to compare Ireland with your favorite country, whatever it is, I'm not going there, you can do and then see how the HDI and other indicators look like. You can do that. You can do it for a sub-region. You can do for a particular region. You can do it among countries. You can do it Ireland between 1990 and 2015. So you can do that.
I think you're in a room where everybody would agree with what you say in terms of our hopes and our dreams and our aspirations for the kind of world that we foresee. However, if you look at populism, nationalism, if you look at civil society space closing down, if you look at the will of some governments, if you look at autocracy, I'm just wondering in that context, you know, it's great to dream and have aspirations and to work hard to creating this world that we want, but how are we going to dismantle these gigantic, in my opinion, barriers so we can create this human development world where everybody is equal and cherished?
Let me answer your question at three levels. First is, I think if you are a pessimist, you should not be in development business. In development business, there's no room for pessimism, and I personally believe that pessimism doesn't have anything positive. The second is, when you talk about the dream, let me get back to 1964-63 in the US. There was apartheid. There was all kinds of violation of rights of African Americans, and they did not have voting rights, they did not have civil rights. Still, one man dreamt at that particular point in time, who said, "I have a dream," and over the last 50 years, we have made progress there. The civil rights are there. There have been lots of developments in terms of, for example, the rights of the African Americans and all kinds of things. If we go back, for example, in 1988 and 1987, who have dreamt at that point in time that the Berlin Wall would be broken or there will be an end of apartheid in South Africa? So therefore, yes, we are in a very tormented time. There's no doubt about it. I fully agree with you. But that does not necessarily mean that we cannot overcome those. This is, as an economist, I see in terms of a business cycle. You have a trough, and then you have a you have a peak. So some of the things that are happening on both sides of the Atlantic and also in other parts of the world, I think they will come to end, because nowadays people are mobilizing themselves, people are trying to overcome those things, people are having the discussions and everything. The role of the report, actually, not to come up with solutions, we don't have it, but to raise issues, and the role of the report is to initiate a dialogue and a discussion based on evidence. So it's not a rhetorical report, it is evidence-based report. So we always expect that different development partners, whether it is government, whether it is the external development partners, civil society, academics and researchers, they will take the report, run away with it, and will use the report in their various platforms to raise voices, to put pressures, and that kind of thing. And then there will be changes, slowly. My last and final point is, I am a great believer of the fact that development is not a sprint, it is a marathon. And development is not a snapshot, it is a continuum. So it will take time, but we'll overcome this.
Lorraine Gallagher, Global Health Advisor with Irish Aid, and thank you for that very interesting synthesis. I'd just be really interested to get your views on the changing landscapes in terms of investments in social sectors. So we see a lot of shifting sands, we see a change in the modalities used, pool funds being threatened, bilaterals pulling out of social sectors, budget support, etc., becoming a little bit passé. And I suppose there's some concern in terms of, in light of this, that there could be a tendency to go back to fragmentation, leaving sector approaches where you'd like to have that overall view. So certainly not wanting to be pessimistic, but I'd be really interested to hear your optimism or where you see opportunities in terms of that changing context that we find ourselves in. Thank you.
Very good question. I think first I would say that whenever there is a kind of a backlash or whenever there's a crisis, just say economic crisis also, it is always the social sector which are cut first, because these are soft sectors, so you always cut education, you always cut health services, you always cut other social services. So with the kind of the situation we are in, this phenomenon is not new. This has happened also in different parts of the world at different points in time. So that said, I think that three things need to be kept in mind. One is that when we talk about the expenditure in the social sector, and this particular report also makes reference to it, it makes a lot of difference whether we are talking about expenditure in the social sector in general or we are talking about expenditure in social sector where the human priorities lie. One very simple example, when we are spending money on, say, healthcare centers, are we building nice hospitals in urban cities, or are we building the mother childcare centers in rural areas? And for human development, for everyone, it is absolutely important that you take the social sector, but within the social sector also, you focus on where the human priorities lie, whether it is basic education in Malawi, or whether it is child health care center in Ghana. Those are the things that need to be done. So that's my first point. And I think we have to push for that. Second comes the whole question of the efficiency in resource use. I think this is where there are lots of leakages in the social sector also, in various forms that we know of. And if we can really, you can call it corruption, it could call it other things, but it's basically, at the end of the day, the resources are being leaked out. If we can stop that, and if we can improve the efficiency in resource use, your $1 or £1 can do the work of $2 or £2. So I think that's important to remember. The third and the final point is that nowadays a lot of the basic social services are also provided by the civil society and the NGOs. You go to any part of the developing world, it's no longer the area where only the government is the actor, but lots of the NGOs, lots of the civil society organizations, whether national, global, or local, are also providing that services. Take the example of Bangladesh. One of the reasons why the education has been very widespread and the girls' enrollment rate and girls' retention rate in schools have gone up is because there is an NGO called BRAC who has been very active there. And some of the innovations BRAC has brought about has the implications for other societies as well. I mean, BRAC started with non-formal education, but they have brought in two innovations. One is that they, in every school that they have set up, they have provided separate toilets for girls. And the second thing they did, that whenever the girls are enrolled, they provided two sets of uniforms for girls. Because in any society, and particularly in a society like Bangladesh, boys can go to school. I mean, if they have a kind of a short or the kind of a trouser, they don't need anything. But with girls, you need to have the kind of the appropriate attire to go to school. That thing have changed the whole question of the enrollment attendance of girls. In many societies, school meal program has had a tremendous impact in terms of retaining children in school, in terms of nutritional value of the what they are eating, in terms of basically enhancing the local economy, because they are also the provider of the food stuff that goes to school meals. So I think if we look at that whole issue of the social sector spending in the broader perspective, there are actors, there are ways in which we can actually try to compensate some of the backlashes that we'll be facing in coming days.
Thank you.
Can I just ask a question? At a time now where we have such a number of displaced people, we have 65 million displaced people, and there's a real risk that their lives will become permanently temporary, that they will be living in transitional accommodation maybe for a generation. How do you capture those people and what's happening there?
I think that's a very good question. On average, and it may seem startling to you, but this is true, on average, a person who is a refugee spent 17 years in camps. And when I made that statement somewhere, they said it cannot be true. I said it is true, because just think of the Palestinian refugees. Starting from 1960, it is the fourth generation or even the fifth generation who are in camps. So if you take the average, it comes to 17 years. So you said permanently transitory. I think that's a very good term. How do we capture it? I think one is the capturing the issues capturing the data, and other is what can be done about it. The kind of the data to capture those people have two problems. One problem is when we talk about the refugees, they may not be living in one place. They are on the move all the time. So it may be quite difficult to capture them. There may be double counting, there may be missing data, and that kind of thing. So while we are working also with the IOM, and also in many cases, different NGOs to try to capture it, the numbers and everything. Are those numbers absolutely correct? No. Are those numbers totally dependable? No. But those provide a kind of an indication of the extent of the problem. I mean, when I say 65 million, is it a correct number? Maybe, may not be. But it also shows you the extent and the depth of the problem. When you say that this figure is more than the population of France, that tells you the severity of the problem. So that's one way of capturing. The second way where we are focusing, and I think this is important, because lots of these displaced people are children, 28 million. Now, apart from being children, you also have to focus on the fact that when they are in the refugee camp, they're not getting any education. There are no school, there is no education. So we may have a total generation which would be missed through this process. So in many cases, working with development partners, I think there are temporary schools, there are temporary teaching classes to teach those people there. And my final point is that it is also a question of perspective to these people. One is, of course, the humanitarian perspective. When you say it's a refugee and they are moving from one place to another, definitely we have to take a more human approach to that. But at the same time, what I would argue, sometimes when we look at this population, we always look it from the perspective of security, not from the perspective of economic opportunity. And I think the time has come when societies, while they discuss those issues in their context, should look at it also from the economic opportunities point of view. In many societies, population growth is negative or even zero or even negative. In many societies, there may be a problem down the road where there may not be enough people in the labor force. In many societies, lots of the sectors, lots of the services are very much dependent on the people who have migrated there. So I think if we take it from the larger perspective and discuss it within the society, given the norms and the values of the society, we can address that problem.
Thank you. Max first, yeah, thank you.
Good morning. My name is Max Münchmeier. I'm a researcher here at the Institute, and one of my portfolios is the energy portfolio, and in that context, I'm quite interested. You see them sort of quite a lot now in the news, these systems for microgrid and off-grid systems for rural sustainable electrification. I was just very interested in your views, what your views would be on the global regime of technology transfer. Is enough being done in that area? And secondly, the efforts globally to build local ownership and capacity to actually use those technologies.
Good. Thank you. I thought that you were going to ask me a very technical question on energy, which I'm not an expert. Let me start with some figures first. One is that in 2016, I think with the building of 500,000 solar power panel every day, that was the first year when the green energy has actually surpassed the coal-based energy, which is good news. And related to that, there are efforts, large efforts, in countries like China and India for solar energy, wind energy, others, which is another good news because we are talking about 3 billion people there. The second issue is that I think this is more of a policy issue, the kind of the subsidies that the coal-based industry enjoy. That comes to around 550 billion a year. So I think that's another issue one has to look at. Then coming back to your question, in many societies, the off-grid, small-scale, local-level generation of energy may be the solution for a number of reasons. One is then you can reach different households at the community level. The second one is the operations and maintenance can be taken up by the community. The third issue that when you have a big on-grid electrification system, there's always this power stealing, let's put it that way. So therefore, just like the irrigation projects where the small-scale irrigation pumps can really help the farmers, this is also true of the energy. The second point is that energy should be looked at not only from the provision of energy, but also from a larger development perspective. It can have a real development impact in terms of enhancing entrepreneurship. B, when you have electricity and everything, that is also clean energy. So therefore, the whole question of the indoor air pollution because of use of other kinds of energy can be avoided, which have an impact on women and girls who spend most of their time indoors. Actually, 2 million women and girls die every year because of the indoor pollution. And the third thing is that when you have electrification in the on the local level, on the small-scale electrification thing, it also helps education, because then you have electricity where children can learn and children can do their homework, that kind of thing. Second part of your issue is that there are lots of experimentation when you talk about technology in terms of innovation, in terms of using new things that are happening in different parts of the developing countries. So I think South-South collaboration can be a very good platform to get those experiences, to get those technologies across countries so that we can learn from each other. This has been happening in other parts of the development business, for example, in social protection. There are lots of South-South dissemination of experiences. In Latin America, they are experimenting with the Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme of India. But I think energy is also one sector where it can happen. The multifunctional platform that are being used in East Africa, for example, where you can have clean energy within the households with the kind of the impacts that I have talked about, is something that we can use in other places. There is clean oven project in Vietnam and other places which have really revolutionized the rural economy, can also be used. So yes, in terms of technology transfer, it should not be only the technology from big companies or big countries or big concerns, but it can be technology from countries within the developing world through South-South platform. Yes.
Thank you.
A question based on the chair's previous question and your remarks on the labor force and economic benefits of displaced people. In Europe and the EU closer to home, a lot was made of this on the Remain side of the Brexit arguments, and I don't want to make this a Brexit discussion, but how can this was used, this idea was used on the Remain side, and I was wondering how, and obviously didn't work on the grand scale, but how can this argument be made to people? I know in Germany when they opened themselves up and opened the EU up to many Syrian refugees and asylum seekers, people were quite skeptical that they needed this, and they needed the people in the labor force, and people maybe didn't believe that they were just being humanitarian, that this was a backhanded reason. But how do you make the argument that it's both, it's beneficial and it's humanitarian? How do you open this up to governments that are maybe more populist and right-wing leaning?
Mm-hmm. I think it would depend on how you argue for that and how you have the discussion within the society. This is not easy. I'm not saying it is easy. And if you look at the reaction of different European countries, you also see the different differences in the approaches. For example, I have been in Iceland, small country, a very small country with a very small population. But there's a vibrant discussion. There's been paper by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs on the whole question of what are the benefits that the migrants and the refugees can bring, what are the downside of it. But that's a healthy discussion that have to happen there. In every society, in all times, whenever there are newcomers, there have been resistance. And that is true. That is always true of human nature. When we grew up, the new kid on the block has always been bullied. We did it, right? So therefore, that is going to be there, that first there will be resistance to people from a view, a point of view of culture, point of view of norm and other things. But I think we also have to get beyond the issue of narrow identity. Lots of the things that you have talked about, lots of the resistance also come from that. All of us, each one of us, have multiple identities. I mean, if I take myself, I'm a man, I'm a South Asian, I'm a professional, I'm of certain age, I'm father to two daughters, different. And as long as we can have respect for multiple identities of everyone, and as long as we treat them with dignity, whatever identity they have, the chances of conflict and, for example, tension is less. But if for me, if I only try to define myself only as a man, and I feel that that gives me a superior identity to any other identity that I have talked about, then the first thing I'll have is that I'll have a very negative attitude to women. I'll not be respectful of their rights. I'll not be respectful of their potentials. And therefore, a conflict will occur vis-a-vis me and my women colleagues, my family within the household, other women in the society and everything. And then I will say that, well, women should not be in the workforce, they should stay home, they should not be seen outside, they should remain inside, and that kind of thing. So therefore, I think the whole question of the identity and respecting that identity, discussing and having the notion of broader identity in every society would be helpful. And I think that is something that is happening in many societies slowly. Do we see it at a macro level? May not be in many societies, I agree with you, but I think it will take time and we'll have that.
Well, can I, on your behalf, say thank you for a really most interesting and encouraging presentation, Dr. Jahan. I think it's been immensely valuable for all of us to have heard the information, and I think it's been very inspiring.
Thank you.
To listen to you and to understand that not only more can be done, but that so much more can be achieved. So thank you very much indeed.